So good morning to everyone. Today
Good
we will
morning.
discuss
Good
a topic
morning.
on basic statistical methods. So previous day we discussed about what is mean by statistics and what are the importance of statistics and what are the uses of statistics in our economics. Okay, so today we will discuss that what are the basic statistical methods are there in our statistics. So what I'm going to explain, so as per that Croxton and Cowden, so what are the basic statistical methods are there? So today we will discuss. So the statistical methods are, we need to understand, say simple, there is a collection, organization, presentation, analysis, and interpretation. So earlier we came to know that only collection, presentation, analysis, and interpretation, that is a CBAI. So as per the Croxton and Cowden, so here see what are the statistical methods are there in our statistics. So the first one is the collection of the data, and second one is the organization, third one is the presentation, fourth one is the analysis, fifth one is the interpretation. So here what is mean by collection of the data? What is mean by data? First we come to know that, then only after that how we can collect the data, that is the main thing. So can anybody can say that what is mean by data? Can anybody can say that?
It is information, sir.
Yeah, see, the data nothing but is a, it contains the information, that is nothing but information about the particular variable. For example, if I want to know that what is your age, the age is a particular variable. So I want to know that what is your age of the classroom. So then I will ask the question to each and everyone, what is your age? Somebody will say they're 17, somebody will say 20, somebody is 19, so like this. So that age is nothing but is a variable. So I am collecting information with regard to particular variable, that is age. So that is called collection of the data. So in the collection of the data, we have the two approaches. Okay, we have the two approaches. Then we'll come to know that one by one. See, the primary data. So data contains the nothing but data. There are two types of data. Basically, the first one is a primary data. Second one is a secondary data. What is mean by primary data? Can anybody can say that? What is mean by primary data?
Sir, raw data.
Primary data is also known as the raw data. And can anybody say another?
Sir, first time information dot.
Yeah, first hand information data, very good. Then any another person can explain about what is my primary data? Yeah, both are good. There is a first information and see, the primary data is a data. Primary data is a data which is collected from directly respondents. Primary data is a data which is collected from directly respondents. So are you clear that primary data is a data which is collected from directly respondents? For example, so I want to know that what is your age. Okay, so what is my respondents? You people are the my respondents. If I collect directly from you, that is called primary data. Okay, there is a first hand information. Okay, so primary data is also known as a raw data. For example, if you take another example, surveys or opinion polls. For example, if you take into account in any state, election will going on. Okay, election will be happen. So before election, what they will do, the some political parties, some news channels, so they will collect information about the which party is going to win, right? So some representatives, for example, the person, they will collect information from the public. Okay, so whatever they're collect going to collect the information, that information is called primary data. Is it clear, dear students?
Sir, some are asking to let them in, sir.
Yeah, just a minute. Yeah. Are there Jain as to know? Yeah, no, nobody there. See. Yeah. So the primary data is clear. Hello, dear students.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Fine. Yeah. And the example is surveys and opinion polls. For example, if you take into account the National Sample Survey of Organization or National Sample Survey of Office, NSSO. So they will conduct a research on particular thing. For example, if it is unemployment or poverty, what they will do? Simple, they will collect information from the public. And they will give the results, nothing but they will publish a book in the form of a book. Okay, so whatever they will do, some surveys, the surveys, most of the surveys are depends on the primary data. Okay, for example, if you take into know that another example I'm going to give that so satisfaction level of the customers. For example, if you take the DMart people or some big buzzers, for example, what they will do, you know, what they will want to know that they want to know that what is the customer's satisfaction levels. Are they satisfied with that company, or are they satisfied with that mall or not? So what they will do is simple, they will collect information from the customer, those who will visit the big bazaar or DMart or another mart, for example. So they will collect information with regard to particular variables. What is your name, and are you satisfied with our staff, our security guards? For example, they will prepare questions. Okay. And they will take opinion from the customers. Okay, so that is also called survey, right? Am I clear, dear students?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Then, another one, the secondary data. Can anybody can say what is called a secondary data?
Secondary data.
Sir, data gathered from studies or surveys or secondary data
like shape of finished goods.
Yeah. Secondary data is nothing but simple. We can say second hand data. We can say simple. As we told, the primary data is nothing but first hand information. So this is the second data is nothing but second hand information. We can say that. Secondary data is a data which is published by someone else. Okay. For example, if you take census, for example, how many population in our country? How do we know that? Do we collect the information? Can anybody can say? Do we collect the information about the how many people are living in India? No. So here the government can collect the information with regard to population, how many population in surrounding in any particular location, in state, in Andhra, in Telangana, or Bihar, or Orissa, or Chhattisgarh, or UP, or Delhi, like this. So secondary data is a data which is collected by someone else and published by someone else. Okay, so if you collect that information, it is called secondary data. For example, if you take published source, for example, if you want to take a production of rice, do you collect that how much production takes place in particular state? No. So here, meanwhile, the concerned department, here each and every state, they have that director of economics and statistics. So they will collect information with regard to particular variables, and they will publish in the form of book. Okay, so if you collect that information, that is called secondary data, because somebody has collected data and somebody has published data. If you collect that information, that is called secondary data. So example is census, or if you take the production, or if you take the IIP industrial index of industrial production, repo rates, or exchange rates. Am I clear, dear students, about secondary data?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Simple, secondary data is nothing but second hand information. Simple, we can say that second hand. For example, if you purchase a vehicle, so the vehicle is your fresh data, nothing but new vehicle. So if you sell to someone else, it just comes under the second hand, like this. For example, if you purchase a new vehicle, this comes under the primary data. If you sell to someone else after purchasing, so that is called second hand. How we can use that word? Like this, in your data also, if somebody is collected, if you take the data, that is called second data for you. Am I clear once again?
Yes, sir.
Then. So this is a collection of the data. So here the primary data we can collect through different things, nothing but through a schedule, through questionnaire, Okay, so there is a difference between the schedule and questionnaire also. See, so if you, what is meant by questionnaire? Questionnaire is nothing but is a set of questions. Questionnaire is nothing but set of questions. For example, if you take into account the question paper. So in the question paper, what they have, what are there? There are number of questions. Number of questions, it is called question paper, like this. So when you are preparing a questions with regard to particular survey, with regard to particular objectives, so that is comes, that is called questionnaire. Questionnaire is nothing but set of questions. Set of questions, that is called questionnaire. So the questionnaire, when they will use the questionnaire, for example, the questionnaire will be used for unknown, nothing but uneducated people mainly. For example, for example, if you want to collect information with regard to farmers, most of the farmers are uneducated, so we can assume in a particular village. So will they, if you give that questionnaire to someone, the farmers, are they able to write, are they able to answer from themselves? No. So meanwhile, you need to take, okay, and there is a schedule also. See, so there is a little bit difference between schedule and questionnaire. For example, if you take into account, some people, if you send, if you give the question to someone, okay, so they will fill and they will give the back. And schedule is nothing but same, but the questionnaire for the, sorry, I think questionnaire for the literate people, scheduled for the illiterate people, we can say simple, schedule for the literate people, and questionnaire for the scheduled literate people, scheduled for the uneducated people. Okay, so here, see, for example, if you send the questionnaire to someone, for example, if you want to know that, if you want to collect information from the software engineers, what they can do, you cannot meet personally the software engineers, but they can do simple, you can send the questionnaire through mail. So simple, they will read the question and they will give the answer. They will give the answer to particular questions and they will send the back to your mail. So that is a questionnaire. Schedule is nothing but, for example, if you go to someone, if you want to collect information with regard to farmers, simple, you can, yourself only, you need to fill up the questions, because you may ask the question to someone, farmers, but the farmer can reply the answer, but they will not fill it the your question thing, but they will not write on your questionnaire. So that is a schedule. So am I clear about questionnaire and schedule?
Yes sir.
There. So if the time permits, we will discuss in the next class also, when how we can collect the primary data in the next another module also we can discuss briefly. Then after collecting the data, what we have to do, simple, we need to organize it. See, after collecting the information from the sample of the respondents, what you have to do, you need to do the edit. So you need to go through the each and every question, whether are they responded or not. For example, if you ask some questions, somebody may skip it out, so you may not attend that question to answer. So sometimes we need to take their mobile numbers and their ID, mail IDs and their phone numbers. When a particular question is not answered, so after that we need to call to them and we can ask that question. If they will reply to the particular question, we need to add it. That is the editing. Then classification. So see, when you are collecting information, so the data is depends on the, when you are collecting information, so we need to classify it. For example, if you collect the information from the farmers, what we have to do, so farmers are, there are different types. For example, if you take marginal farmers, small farmers, medium farmers, large farmers, it depends on the farm size, so you may classify it. For example, if you collect information from the industries, you may collect from the labors, you may collect from the entrepreneurs. Okay, so that kind of, when you have the data, you can classify it. Okay, so the tabulation, you can do the tabulation also. When you are presenting also, the tabulation takes place. Okay. Somebody is in. Yeah, no one is in. Then after organizing the data, the third one is a presentation. So here, see, after collecting the data, you are going to edit. Then how you can present the data. That is the main thing. See, where it is required, we can put that kind of presentation. For example, how we can put the graphs? Can anybody can say that instead of data, how, why we can put that graphs or tables?
We can understand the information fastly, sir.
Yeah, simple, they can understand by looking at the graph. For example, if you say this graph, see, for example, so this this green, see, this color is highest, the pink color is somewhat less than this colors. Okay, so for example, if you take this graph, histogram, see, so the red color people are highest, for example, if you take into account. Simple, on the, for example, instead of giving the data, simple, we can present the graphs, because easy to understand. Okay, see here, on here, see, when you are doing the research, simple, you need to present tables, graphs, and whichever is applicable for your thing. So for example, if you take this a bar diagram, where we can use bar diagram, that is the main thing, sorry, pie diagram. Okay, for example, if you take into account, so this is our university, for example, how many BSc students are there, how many BS students are there, how many MS students are there, like this, we can present nothing but we can show percentage. So which nothing but which nothing but whether the BSc people are higher than the other people, or MA people, or MSc people, or BA people, we can show like this pie diagram. And Voegelin curves, so if you want to show that curves, you may use like this. And histograms, if you want to know that, for example, if you consider the five subjects, for example, so which subject you got more marks, for example, if you have the three or four subjects, no? For example, if you have the five subjects, so if you got highest marks in economics, so if you get less marks compared with the economics, like this, I mean, mathematical economics, other economics, or English, something, for example, so you may put this kind of graphs, histograms. So by using easily the red color for economics, this color for mathematics, this color for some English, or this color for other subject. So by looking at this graph only, you can easily understand by looking at red color is economics. So here, so particular person has got more marks in economics compared with the other subjects. We can conclude easily, right?
We are not able to see the graph.
Just a minute, I think. Just a minute. Now?
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir. No.
Just a minute.
Yeah, now I can see, sir.
Yeah, slowly you will get it.
Yes, sir.
Wait. See here, the histogram. Are you able to see this one?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, see. For example, if you want to show that, for example, as for classroom wise, for example, how many marks secured by a particular person? For example, if you take yourself, say, this is economics marks, this is a mathematics marks, this is a stats marks, mathematics marks, other subject marks, for example. So if you get more marks in economics, if you put histogram, so what other people can understand by looking at red color, for example, we need to indicate red color for economics, this color for mathematics, this color for some other subjects. So by looking at this graph only, we can see the red colors, nothing but if it is economics, the economics, the particular person has secured more marks in economics compared with the other subjects. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Please explain one second, sir.
Yeah. So for example, if you take into account, in your economics statistics subject, you may get 90 marks. Okay. For mathematics, you may get 80 marks. In other subject, you may get 70. In other subject, you may get 60. And other subject, you may get 50. For example, if you put in the table form, economics 95, mathematics 90, other subject 80, other subject 70, other subject 60. Yes. Yeah, if you present in the table form, so there is some confusion. Each and every time you need to check whether which subject is got highest marks. So when you put a histogram, okay, So simple, we can see that which red color is indicated with for economics. So we can easily conclude that the particular person has secured highest marks in economics compared with the other subjects. Am I clear?
Sir, but sir, we can represent subjects in histogram.
Yeah.
We can show subjects in bar graph.
Yeah. Histogram, bar graph, more or less similar, but there is small difference. Okay. So yeah, see histogram here, this is a bar graph also here. For example, if you put like this, there's a bar graph. See. So you will get, for example, if this is for mathematics, for example, this color, for example. So by looking at this graph, I will say that so in the particular person has secured more marks in mathematics compared with the statistics and other subjects. Okay. Simple. Here, instead of putting tables, you will present in the form of graphs, because when you are presenting a table, the other people may not able to understand easily. In order to get easy understanding, so most of the people will present graphs. Okay. I think I'm getting some disturbance from someone. Please unmute yourself. When I ask the question, you will. Yeah. After presentation, you need to analyze the data. For example, this is another graph. So if you want to know that types of bars, you can take into account the simple bar diagram. See, red color, blue color, green color, black and pink. Okay, which are based on the numerical set of single numerical data. The red, blue, green, black, pink. If you have multiple bar diagrams, see within the diagram also, see this which shows that two or more sets of the data simultaneously. For example, if you take this is one set of data in one person has got these marks, particular subjects. For example, if you take the five students, if I take and consider, so mathematics, statistics, and other microeconomic subjects. So in another person, if you consider red color for the economics, statistics, this middle color is mathematics, this other for other subject. So if you compare this and this person, so he has got more marks in this particular subject, microeconomics, whereas another person, he has secured less marks compared with these two persons. So you will take such kind of multiple bar diagrams and subdivide bar diagrams. So here, see which percentage is higher, we can show easily. So this may be useful when you are going to write your dissertation, if you have the dissertation. Okay, so if you want to do research on it, it may be useful more. Then deviation bar and category map diagram also we can show. Then after presentation, how we are going to analyze it. For example, if you put the table, how we are going to analyze, that is the main thing. As I told you that if the red color is highest, the red color for economics, how we are going to analyze it. So simple, we can see that a particular person has secured highest marks in economics compared with or compared to other subjects. Simple, we can write it. So here, see, the analysis part that will be done using statistical techniques. So when we are using statistical techniques, so where it can be applicable, that is the main important. Each and every time we cannot use all the techniques. Where it is necessary, the technique should be used. Okay, so here, see, where it can be applicable, in that case only we can use statistical technique. For example, averages, ratios, CV, the coefficient of variance or variations, correlation, regression, chi-square test, t-test, f-test, z-test. So there are other techniques also there, but I have mentioned only few. Okay, so where it can be applicable, then we will come to then we will use that statistical technique only. Am I clear with the students? Hello?
Yes, sir.
So here, when you're analyzing on the base of average, for example, we can say that on the base of on average, the students have secured highest marks in one subject compared with the other subjects. So when there is a correlation between the two, as I told you earlier in the last class, see number of attendance and their marks. So if I take the data from you out of from 30 samples in your class. So if I want to know that whether is there any impact of my class on the particular students, so those who attend the my class, are they get more marks in my subject or not? So I want to know that, I want to interrelate that number of attendance, nothing but percent of attendance and percent of marks or number of marks. So if I want to relate the both variables, I may use the correlation, because if I use the correlation only, then I may clear that, so is there any relation or not, right? So it just depends on the where it can be applicable. Simple. If I want to correlate, if I want to know the, if I want to link the two variables, then I may use correlation. So if I want to know that regression, there is a cause and effect relationship, so I may use regression. Okay, I may use the regression for that same, there is a number of attendance, percent of attendance and number of marks, percent of marks. Okay, so when they will increase the number of attendance, so they may be going to get more marks. When there is a relation, I may use regression. Okay, so other techniques will be applicable where it can be necessary. Okay, is it understood how we can analyze the data?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, thank you. Then, for example, I have used that mean, that is averages, there's economic growth, exports, imports and capital. So I use the averages, how much average of economic growth during the particular period, how much average exports in the particular period. So like this, I may use median, mean, maximum, how much minimum value, like how much minimum of exports, how much maximum of output exports, how much the deviation, standard deviation. So this it can be applicable where we can use. So we can discuss briefly in the next class where it can be applicable, mean, median, mode and minimum, maximum, standard deviation. We will come to know after next class. Then interpretation is a main important. The interpretation is a main thing which we can use each and every analysis in each and every research paper or dissertation thesis. So after analysis, so it helps in rational decision making. For example, if you take into account how we are interpreting the results, that is the main thing. For example, something, if you take into account, some people may interpret wrongly, some people may interpret correctly. So how we are interpreting, that is the main thing in our research, in our business economics or in economics. For example, if you take into account, if the price of the commodity increases from 10 rupees to 15 rupees, how much demand falls down? Can anybody can say that? Generally, in our economics, what we will say that if the price of the commodity increases from 10 to 15 rupees, how much demand is going to fall down? How we can say, dear students, can anybody can say that? Hello? Hello?
So can you please repeat the question?
See, if the price of the commodity increases from 10 rupees to 15 rupees, how much the demand falls down?
Six.
No.
So without knowing at the price of 10, how many demand, how?
Yeah, good, good. See here, yeah, we don't have the data, we cannot say that, because how much the demand fall down? Because when you have the data only, definitely, see, the price increases from 10 to 15 rupees, demand is going to fall down. But we cannot say exactly how much demand fall down, right? So when you have the data, earlier data, so we can easily interpret the data, right? For example, if you take into account, when we have the data, previously 10 years data or 15 years or 30 observations or 10 observations, so we may run regression analysis. So after running the regression analysis, for example, if you get the QD equation, that is the quantity demand is equal to 10 minus 2P, if P is equal to 2, how much the quantity demand? See here, see this is the equation. This is the equation. Simple, you can remember that this is the equation. 10 minus 2P. This is a regression equation, like, or else a function. You can say that 10 is nothing but constant value, minus 2 is nothing but coefficient value or slope, P is nothing but price, QD is nothing but demand. the quantity minus depends on price. Why I put minus here? Because there is an inverse relationship between quantity demand and price. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, that's why I put minus. Don't confuse how 10 has come and 2 has come. You will come to know that in time series data or in the regression part only, you will come to know the how 10 has and 2 has come. So this is a A value and this is a B value. Don't worry. Y is equal to A plus BX. That is a regression formula. Or simple Y is equal to MX plus C in mathematics people. Okay. So here, this is a MX, MX value. X is nothing but P. Here, my M value is nothing but minus 2. C value is nothing but 10. Okay. So how it has come, don't confuse. So this is an example I have taken. So how 10 is minus 2 come, nothing but it just depends on the previous data. If you have the data of 10 observations, if the price is 10 rupees, how much demand? If the price is 12 rupees, how much demand? If the price is 13 rupees, how much demand? If the price is 14 rupees, how much demand? If the price is 15, then how much we can explain how much demand fall down, right? So here, QD is not, QD is equal to 10 minus 2P. 10 minus 2P. If the P is equal to, how much quantity demand is equal to, how much quantity demand. So simple, when they will ask the question like this, QD is equal to 10 minus 2P, if the price is equal to, how much the quantity demand. Simple, we can substitute the P value in the equation, that is the QD is equal to 10 minus 2P. So then is equal to 10 minus 2, so your P value is nothing, how much 2. You can substitute the P value in the equation, then is equal to 10 minus 2 into 2, 2 into 2, 4, 10 minus 4, then 10 minus 4, how much? 6. I make clear, dear students, when the price of the commodity is 2,
yes,
the demand for the goods is 6. Can anybody get say that if the price of the commodity is 3 rupees, how much the demand?
4.
So 10 minus 6, 4.
4. If the price of the commodity is 1, how much the quantity demand?
8.
Yeah.
Eight.
So if the price of the commodity is 4, how much the quantity demand?
2.
So what you observe here?
Value.
Yes, sir. Yeah, what? Hello?
As price value. Demand decreases, sir.
Yeah, see, as price increases, the quantity demand is going to fall, right? As price decreases, the quantity demand is increases.
Yes, sir.
Right. See, that is the beauty of statistical methods in economics. So when you're, for example, at the plus 2 level, most of the people will say, told you that, so as the price increases, the quantity demand fall down. But when the price increases from 1 rupees to 2 rupees, how much the quantity demand fall down, they didn't teach it. Okay. So that is the beauty of methods in our economics. So I think, I hope you understood how we can estimate and how we can predict the values, how we can interpret the values. Right?
Yes, sir.
So simple, we can conclude here. We can conclude by looking at this equation. That is, see, the price of the commodity increases by 1 rupee, the demand is going to fall down by 2 units. 2 units. Right? The price of the commodity increases by 1 rupee, the demand fall down by 2 units. 2 units. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, for example, as I told you that the price of the commodity 3 rupees, the demand is 4. Say so here, if the price increases by 1 rupee, the demand fall down by 2 quantities or 2 units. Okay. Okay. Is it clear? How we can what are the statistical methods as per the Cruxton and Coden? Hello, dear students.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, do you have any doubt with regard to these things? String methods. Yeah. So, here, when we are discussing that, collection of the data. So as we discussed that, how we can collect the data? That is the primary data, second data. So when you are taking into account primary data, okay. So the primary data is how we can take the primary data by selecting a sample, right? So then we will come to know that what is mean by population and what is mean by sample, right? Then only we will come to know after collecting the data, after collecting primary data and second data, we will come to know how we can organize, how we can presentation, how we can analyze, how we can interpretation, right? So mostly our statistical methods for economics depends on these five things only. Simple, you can remember: collection of the data, how we are organizing, how we are presenting, how we are analyzing, how we are interpreting, or interpretation, right? So then we will come to know that another topic. Is it visible for you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yeah, so here we can come to know that distinction between the population and sample. In our main unit, we entered briefly about topic. So what is the difference between population and sample? We can come to know that when we are collecting the information, so we may have the doubt how we can collect the information. That is the main question arises, right? So whether we need to take population or whether we need to take sample, right? Then in the introduction part, simply, the people often fail to properly distinguish between population and sample. So mostly when we are at beginning, as a beginners, we can come to know that simply we can fail to properly. So what is the difference between population and sample? Okay. So it is, however, essential in any statistical analysis, starting from descriptive statistics with different formulas for variance and standard deviation, depends on whether we face a sample or population. Simple here, see, when we are collecting information, we may have the doubt of then where we can collect the information, whether from population or from sample. That is the main question. Then if you take it in analysis part, after taking data, whether we can follow descriptive statistics with the different formulas. For example, if you have to calculate that mean, median, mode, maxima, minima, cutoffs, and you will get more when you, after completion this class also. So this is called descriptive statistics, and it is depends on the whether we face a sample or population. That is the main thing. Then moreover, the branch of statistics called inferential statistics. So the branch of statistics called inferential statistics. Why there is inferential statistics? Why we can take samples? Why we can take population? Can anybody can say that? In order to survey, or in order to complete our thesis, or in order to complete our dissertation, or in order to do some research, we can take both population and sample. It depends on the your requirement. So here, after collecting the information, you may get a results. The results are called inferential statistics. Inferentials or results. The results are called inferential statistics. So here, the branch of statistics called inference statistics is often defined as the science of drawing conclusions. Have you got that? The science of drawing conclusion. Nothing but when you are doing research after conducting a particular study, so you may get some results. That is called conclusion. The conclusion about population. About population. See, when you collect information from the sample, after getting some results, okay, so the results it may conclude about the total population. For example, see when you are cooking a rice, what you have to do, whether it is a particular whether the particular rice has boiled properly or not. Simple, we can take a sample of some small rice, then we'll come to know that whether the whole rice has boiled properly or not, right? So here that is the case. There is a statistic. Whatever we checked out, whether the particular rice has boiled or not, so after getting the results, then we'll come to know that all rice has been boiled, right? Am I right, are you students?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, that is a thing. Yeah, there's a conclusion about population from the observations made on a representative sample of the population. So here, see that they made a representative of sample of the that population. Whatever we checked out, small bit of rice, that can be represent all the population, all the population. So that is a implicit statistics. Then simple, see that if I conduct a research on a BSc honor students, I may not take 30 students. If I take only 10 students, then I may come to know that. So the 10 students can represent all the class, right? Am I right, dear students?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Then next one is, it is therefore crucial to properly distinguish between two concepts, that is a population or sample. Okay. Then we'll come to know that, see, example, the population. For example, here, if you take, this is your class. This is your class. So if I want to know that, as I told you earlier also, see, I want to know that, I want to get feedback from you on my class. Okay, so how I can take feedback from the class? May I take feedback from all the students? I may take only from few people. Can anybody can say that?
Is this right? Take all our students.
Yeah, one way we can take all the students, and another way
we can have few people.
For example, so I'm teaching to you now, so I may take from all the students. For example, if you take dean or vice chancellor, for example, if they want to know that about my class, okay, will they ask all the students?
No, sir.
No, so they will take only two or three people. So they may ask to you that what is your feedback on particular teacher? Okay, so that is called sample. If they will pick one or three people from your class, that is called sample, right? So what is the process involved to take a sample from the population? That is called sampling. Just a minute, getting disturbance from the, yeah, see here, see, this is a population. When you are taking a sample from the population, what is the process involved to take a sample from the population? That is called sampling. So when you're taking a sample, this one, see, this is called sample. So what are the process involved in selecting a sample from the population is called sampling, right? So after selecting a sample, for example, if you take into account, as I told you that the vice chancellor want to know that feedback on my class. So the vice chancellor may take 10 students, nothing but they will take feedback from 10 students. So after taking 10 students, what they will ask the question, they will ask some questions. So whatever you reveal as per the question, that is answers, right? So whatever you give feedback, that is called inference, that is called results. It means that, so that whatever you are going to say, whether my class is good, bad, worst, or very good, like this. So whatever you say, whatever the 10 people say, that results can represent the whole class. Am I right, dear students?
Yes, sir.
Is it clear? So the population is nothing but total information, nothing but total students. Okay. So the vice chancellor want to take a feedback on my classroom. So they will pick up 10 students from the class. Okay. Like this. So he will ask the question that, so are you satisfied with the teacher? How is teaching? Okay. They will ask such kind of questions. So if you give the particular answers, for example, whether it's right or wrong, or good or bad. So whatever you say, he may get some results about classroom or teacher, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that is the differences. Then we will come to know the next line. Then here we will come to know that what is the population. Population, as you know, that a population is also called universe and total information. Simple, you can remember, population is not a public. Please remember. Instead, the population word is the meaning is different. General population meaning is in statistics different. Okay, So the population meaning in statistics is called universe. There is a total information. For example, if you take your classroom, if I want to conduct a research on your classroom, your class people, your student, your total students are called my population. Okay. If I collect information from only 5 people, the 5 people are called sample, right? So here the population is also called universe or total information. Okay. So what is meant by sampling? Sampling is nothing but is a process of selecting an observation or sample to provide an adequate description or inferences of the population. So as I told you that here, sampling means the sampling is a process of selecting a sample from the population. So sampling means it is a process of selecting samples from the population. Simple, you can remember sampling nothing but it is a process of selecting a samples from the population to draw our inferences, to draw an conclusion, to draw an inferences. Right? So here, see the sampling. Yes, please. Yeah, somebody asking question. Can I continue or hello?
Continue, sir.
Yeah, please. Okay. Yeah, sampling is a process of selecting observations. Observations are nothing but sample. Don't confuse. Okay. So sampling is nothing but is a process of selecting observations. Why we can selecting a sample? To provide an adequate in description or inferences about the or of the population, about or of the population. So why we can take a sample? So we can simple, it can be provide an adequate description or inference of the population. Simple, you can remember, see, if I want to know the when you're cooking a rice, okay, so how you are going to take a sample? Nothing but so simple, we can take a sample. Okay, that is called it is a process of selecting observation. So after selecting a sample, what you have to do? You can check whether the particular rice is boiled or not. Okay, so after checking that, so that thing, they can provide an adequate description or inferences of the population. Nothing but after checking that, so we can come to know that all the rice has been cooked properly. Nothing but as the rice has been boiled properly. Am I right? So how we are selecting a sample, and after selecting a sample, you will get some inferences. That is called sampling. Simple, you can remember rice. Only how we are going to cook the rice, you can simply you can remember that rice. And what is meant by sample? Here, sample is also called unit. Sample is also called unit. So unit is, for example, if you take your syllabus. Okay. Your syllabus is called my population. If I select any unit, that is called my sample. Right? So that is unit. Or segment. Segment, nothing but is a one portion, we can say that. And part and subset of the population is called sample. For example, if you take when you are cooking a rice, in order to check whether the boil is properly boiled or not, you may take a pot of rice. Then you will check whether the particular rice has been boiled properly or not. That is a unit or segment or part or subset. Clear? You see why we can see sample is a unit that is selected from population. So simple, the sample will take from the population. So why we can take a sample? Can anybody can say that? Hello, dear students. Why you can take
population, sir?
Yeah, please.
To know the whole population.
To know all the population, or yeah,
save time.
Yeah, the main thing, see here, why we can take sample from the population means the sample can represent all the whole population. See, when you're cooking the rice, so you may check only one part, right? So when you're checking one part, it may represent all the rice in particular bowl. right? So it can represent all population. Then that sample purpose is nothing but purpose to draw the inferences. See, each and every boil rice, we cannot check whether the rice has boiled or not. Can we check when you're cooking, especially for girls? You need to respond.
No, sir.
Boys may cook, but girls may have the more experience than boys. Girls, do you check each and every rice when you are cooking?
No, sir.
Only you can touch only a pot. Then only you can see that whether the rice has boiled or not. That is a pot. When you are checking that pot, that can represent all the rice in particular bowl. So then after checking that rice, you may get result. That is called purpose to draw inferences. Purpose to draw inference, nothing but results. You may conclude whether the rice has boiled or shall we wait for 1 minute or 2 minutes. Am I right, dear students?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Then there is a small difference between the population and sample. Here, population and sample. See, the measurable quality is called parameter. So then we will come to know that what is the difference between parameter and statistic, population parameter and sample statistic. Then here, see, when we are measuring about population, it is called parameter. Okay, when you are measuring something about sample, that is called statistic. Okay, that is statistic. The population is a complete set. Population is a complete set. Here, a sample is a subset of the population. Subset of the population. So, as I told you that, for example, if you take all class, that is your complete set population. If I take only 3 or 4 people from your class, that is called subset of the population. Then, here, reports are a true representation of the opinion. Reports are a true representative of the opinion. But whereas in sample, reports have a margin of error and confidence interval. For example, if you take into account, if I collect information from your class, for example, instead of asking 5 people, if I ask the question, if I ask feedback from all the people, okay, so I will get a good result, nothing but true results. Okay, for example, if I ask the only 5 people, those who are well known to me, for example, what they will give the reply? For example, you people are out of 30 people, the 5 people are well known to me. For example, I am assuming if I ask that only 5 people, what they will do? If I am teaching bad also, they will go, okay sir, fine, good sir. Is it right or wrong?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, see that when you are collecting a sample, so there is some margin of error. When you're conducting a research on whole population, you may get true representation. There is a small difference between the population and sample. That is the case only we may collect from population, we may collect sample. That is the case when you're conducting a research by using a sample, whatever you get some results, the results have a margin of errors and confidence interval. Nothing but I may say that, I may not say 100% that is right. I may say 90% is right. 95% is right, 99% is right. I may exclude 1%. Because when you conduct research on the whole population, for example, if I ask the question that, for example, what is your opinion on my class? All the people, if you say the very bad, for example, if you take, so I may conclude that the report is nothing but the students are not like my class. Right? If I take only if I collect information from the 10 students, so they told that 9, they may say that not bad, sir. They will say like that, for example, not good or not bad, for example, if they will say that. So there is a small error between that total population and other samples. Okay. And population contains all member of the specified group. Yeah, see, the population contain all member of a specified group, and sample, it is a subset that represent entire population. For example, if I am taking to account, I am from economics background. See, if I give more example from the economics only, so other people may not able to understand easily. If I ask that question, so are the example or the whatever I am giving example, are they comfortable for you? Are they easy to understand? The science people may not able to understand easily compared with the arts or economic students. So here, when we are asking all the population that contains all member of specified group. So in your class, most of the people from science and less number of people from arts. So you people have contained the all member of a specified group. You are BSc honors, but in the BSc honors, there are science from there are somebody have science background, somebody have arts background or commerce background. So here in sample, it is subset of that represent all the entire population. For example, if I want to take a sample from your class, if I select only from art students, so that result can be biased somewhere or sometimes. So that is the case. It is a subset that represent the entire population. Am I clear the distinction between that population and sample?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So if it is fine, then I will go for the next slide. Yeah. Then main question will arise that. So we came to know that what is the distinction between sample and population? Clear? Then here there is a main question in statistics. Why sample is needed? Why sample is needed when there is a population? So somebody is told that earlier. What is the need of sample? Somebody that cost, time, right? So these are the things which can affect on selecting a sample. So here, why sample? Nothing but here, before knowing the why sample, the population is the entire group that you want to draw conclusion about the population. Simple. Okay. When you are conducting research on population, if you want to take whole population, so that entire group they involve, and you will want to draw conclusion about the population. See, when you are taking a sample, is a specific group that you will collect data from population. So as I showed that graph, so the population, the sample can take from population only. Okay. So if you want to take information about farmer suicides, so what are the reasons for farmer suicides in some states? How you can take the data? So if you want to visit a particular village, in a particular village there are none 100 farmers are there. So will you able to take 100 farmers? No, you may take a 10 to 20 farmers as your sample. Okay, so the sample is a specific group that you will collect data from population. Out of 100, you may take 10 or 20 samples, right? That is a sample. And the size of the sample is always less than the total size of the population. Simple, when you are taking a sample, the sample size is always less than the total size of the population. You may not take more than some population. No? Sample itself only, we will take a part of the population. We may not take more than population. So simple, this is a common phenomenon. But as I mentioned here, the size of the sample is always less than the total size of the population. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, see, there is some reason. See, what are the reasons for for sampling? So why we can select a sample? What are the reasons are there for sampling? First one is a necessity. What is necessity? Sometimes it's simply not possible to study the whole population due to its size or inaccessibility. For example, if you take into account, if you want to know that what are the reasons for farmer suicides. For example, if you take in particular state, there are 650 farmers have been committed suicides. 650, for example. So, do you want to visit all the state? Nothing but in all the districts. Sometimes you may not go to particular village. There's no proper connection, road connection, or some other connection. Road facilities are not there. Okay, you may not visit all the areas in the particular state. So in that case, you may take a sample from the which district has the highest farmer suicides, right? So you may select that kind of thing, then only you will take sample from the particular state. For example, if you take Maharashtra, the Vidarbha district, which is highest farmer suicides, so you need not to take from sample from the Mumbai. Even Mumbai is under the Maharashtra. So here there is a necessity to select a sample from the population. Okay, then second one is a Is it clear? Necessity? Hello, dear students.
Yes, sir.
The next one is a practicality. So, see, it is easier and more efficient to collect data from a sample. For example, see, when you are involved in a research, so it is very easy to select a sample and more efficient. For example, see, as I told you that if I ask the feedback from old class about my class, some people may ask to your friend, so what you have told to sir. For example, if I ask the question, that is, what is your opinion on my class, only X person if I ask, so Y person what they will do, so Y person may ask to X person, so what did you told to sir? Okay, so here when you are selecting a sample, if I select the sample only, the sample is more easier and more efficient. When you collect a population, so somebody depends on someone like this. Here when you are entered to the practical exercise in a research, conducting a research, so you may get easy when you are collecting a sample, and which is more efficient to collect a data from population. And cost effectiveness. Cost. This is a cost is one of the barrier to the researchers. See, so the researchers want to collect information from all the states, but he or she does not has money to visit a particular district or village. This is a cost effectiveness, because you need to spend a lot of amount, a travel cost and food and bed charges, right? There is a cost effectiveness. There are fewer participants, laboratory equipment and researchers cost involved. For example, if you want to take a research from all the population, so you need to maintain the laboratory. For example, if you take science stream, so for example, if they will collect more in sample, more all population, so they need good laboratory and they need to good equipments. For example, if you take into account corona, so what the government as well, they don't have the good equipments to test whether the particular person has been suffered from corona or not. So yeah, there's a cost effectiveness and research cost involved. For example, you know, to visit particular village, so you need to spend your time, right? Your time, your food expenditure, your transport charges. Okay, these are the cost effectiveness. In that case only we will select a sample from the population. Am I clear, dear students, about cost effectiveness?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, then manageability and storing and running statistical analysis on smaller data sets is easier and reliable. For example, if you collect information from all the population, when you are analyzing the data, it is very headache. Nowadays the softwares are available, but before softwares, most of the people have done manually. For example, if I ask the question to your age, your class people age 1, 18, 16, 19, in order to calculate average, I need to take all the averages on paper, then I need to take calculator, and then I need to enter all those things and sum of values by number of students, then I will get averages. So in software, if I enter the data, it is fraction of seconds, then I will get the data, the results, right? So yeah, manageability. The storing and running statistical analysis. For example, if you take into account the storing and running statistical analysis, that is the biggest thing which the researchers is getting a problem. The storing capacity, nothing but we need to maintain that questionnaires, a set of question. If you take into account, a questionnaire has more than 20 pages also. Sometimes, okay. So when if you want to store, if you collect information from the 1,000 people, so you need to have a good storage place to keep that questionnaires, right? And running statistical analysis on smaller data set. For example, if you run if you take a small sample, you will get the data set is very easy, smaller, which is easy and reliable. Okay, so that is there are other reasons also there for selecting a sample. These are the main reasons for selecting a sample. I make clear, dear students?
Yes, sir.
Do you have any doubt up to now?
Sir, cost
if you have any doubt, cost effectiveness. Yeah, please.
Sir,
shall I explain one second about the cost effectiveness?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, for example, if you want to take population, for example, in your district, you may have the 5,000. If you take your mandal whole population, so there are 5,000 people are living in your mandal. If you take 5,000 as a population, okay. For example, in another mandal, for example, if you take in your district, it is around 100 kilometers. So here in your mandal you may get easily because travel charge is very less. In your mandal you can go to particular villages and you will get data. For example, which is away mandal from your mandal, so you need to go other mandal daily in order to get data. So can you spend more amount or not?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So if you don't mind, may I know that which state you are from?
Bihar, sir.
Bihar. So for example, if you take into account, so if you want to do research on Bihar, okay, so in Bihar there are some districts. For example, if you restrict the district, for example, if you belong to one district, so you can go to particular areas and you will collect information. If you take all the districts in your state, so in order to visit other districts you may spend a lot of amount for the travel. Is it right or wrong?
Sorry, sir.
Yeah, that is a cost of any. Instead of taking all the districts, you may take only one district. That is a sample, right? Or else you may take two or three districts if your those districts are more than 20 or 25. For example, I am belongs to Telangana state. So in our Telangana, there are around 31 districts are there. So I may not visit all the districts in the Telangana. So I may take only two or three districts in Telangana, which is very close to me, right? So I may not visit all the districts. If I visit all the districts, I need to spend a lot of amount for the travel, food expenses, and bed expense, nothing but lodging expenses, right? So that is called cost effectiveness. So in order to reduce the cost, you may take two or three districts for the samples. Am I right?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Do you have any doubt, another person?
No, sir.
Then we came to know that what is my sample and what is my population. What are the reason for selecting a sample? Then what is my sampling? So can anybody say that what is my sampling?
The process of collecting samples.
Yeah, so sampling is nothing but the process of selecting a sample from the population is called sampling. Why we can take a sampling? To draw inferences or to draw some conclusions, right, about the population or of the population, right?
Yes, sir.
See here, this is the main thing. You can take notes also. See, this is the round is nothing but population. Okay, so for example, if you take this is a, you can assume as a state. For example, if you take Bihar, so Bihar people you can take assume as a Bihar. Telangana people you can take as a Telangana, or other people you can take Andhra, for example, population. So what you want to talk about the population, that is your research objectives. For example, what you want to talk about the population. For example, if you take Bihar, so if you want to do research on poverty, right? So if you want to take poverty, so what are the objective, what are the variables can involve in the poverty, how we can measure the poverty, that kind of variables you can take. Okay, so that is the main thing, what you want to talk about the population, right? For example, if you take into account socio-economic conditions, okay, or else if you take into account street vendors income in particular city, in particular district or state. So if you want to talk about the street vendors, so you need to take about the information in the state, how many street vendors are in particular state, and which state, which district has the highest street vendors, or which city has the highest street vendors, right? So that is your main objectives. Nothing but you want to study about the socio-economic conditions of street vendors, right? That is what you want to talk about, right? Then what you have to do, you can take a sampling frame. Anything but what is mean by sampling frame? Simple listing of the population from a sample is chosen. Nothing but we need to write a listing, nothing but number one is name, number two that name, number three. So we need to take a list of street vendors in particular city or district, right? So when you are listing out, you will come to know that how many street vendors in a particular district or how many street vendors in particular state, right? So after confirming that, after how many street vendors are there in particular state, then the sampling process will take place. For example, if you take there are 2000 street vendors in particular city, if you take as you can assume Hyderabad, okay? So you can take example Hyderabad. So see, if I take list from the concerned department, so there are 2000 street vendors are in Telangana state or in Hyderabad, for example. So I may take list, then in order to select a sample, I may not take total 2000 sample, so all population, so I will take only 100 samples from the out of 2000 or 200 sample. So what I can do, simple, I can list out all the names, okay? So then only I will pick up some names, or that is called, I will pick up a sample, that is called sampling process. Nothing but it is a process of selecting a sample from the population, right? This is called sample. So I may take a list of some people, that is sample, okay? So after selecting a sample, what you actually observe in the data, after selecting a sample, what you have to do? Simple, you will collect information from the sample. Then after collecting the information about the sample, you can observe the data. Nothing but what are the socio-economic conditions of the sample households. So you will get some results. That is called inferences. So after getting inferences, you will compare the population. So we can make conclude that, so here, if after conducting a sample survey, if you get a monthly income of the street vendors is 15,000, for example, so that is inferences. We may conclude that all on average of the Hyderabad street vendors, their average income is 15,000 per month. So whatever we get results, that is inferences, can reflect the population or can represent the population. Am I clear, dear students? Do you need any clarification, and you may ask the question?
No, sir.
No, anybody? Yes, please. Yeah, don't you have any doubt? Then I will go for the next slide.
No doubt, sir.
Yeah, thank you. The sampling design process. So how we can do a sampling design process when you are doing a research? This is the main thing which can involve. We need to define. So as I told you that in Hyderabad, how many street vendors are there? We need to define the population. There are 2000 population are there, right? Okay. Determine the sampling frame. Nothing but I need to confirm that out of 2000, how many sample I need to take, right? Hello, dear students. So yes, depend on the population is 2000. Yes, I need to take only 100 sample. That is a determined sampling frame, right? So after determine the sample size, so which method you are going to apply? Nothing but determine sampling procedure. That is called sampling method. Which method you are going to apply to select a sample from the population? So here only confine 100, but I did not take 100. So I need to apply a method how we are selecting a sample. For example, you may have the doubt. For example, I may give conclusion. So for your class, define your population. For example, you are 32 or 30 members, for example, in your class. I need to take feedback from about my class, okay, 30 members. Determine the sample frame. So I want to take a sample of 5 students, for example. Sample is sample frame 5. Then if I ask directly to you, what you can do? For example, if I ask the question to only boys, what girls people will think? So can anybody say that? Hello?
Yes, discrimination.
Yeah, discrimination. Only there is a bias. We can say simple, we can say bias. Yes. Sorry is biased. Only sorry is asking only boys. Sorry is not asking the girls, right? So if I ask the question to only girls, what bias thinks? Discrimination. Sorry is not asking boys only. He's asking only girls, right? So here I need to follow a certain procedures. That is called sampling method. If I ask the only boys, if the girls ask the question, sir, why you are asking question to only boys? Why not you are asking girls? Okay. In that case, I need to apply method. There are two different methods are there. That is probability sampling method and non-probability sampling method. The probability sampling method is also known as the random sampling method. Random sampling method. And here non-probability sampling method is also called non-random sampling method. Non-random sampling method. So on the base of these methods, if I say that, so on the base of this method, I have chosen only boys have been selected. That's why I'm asking only boys. So in that case, only boys will, the girls may not ask the question again, because on the base of some procedure only, I may ask the only boys. I may not ask the girls because their serial number is not included in, not selected in my sample, right? So that is the case on the base of sampling method only. If I say on the base of certain method, so the bias only selected. That's why I'm asking the bias. Okay, the girls, they can never ask the question to me that why you're not selecting girls. Okay. So that is called determined sampling procedure. Sampling procedure. For example, see, generally when you are entering into the research, when you gone to some villages, most of the farmers will ask. For example, if you ask some question to a particular farmer, so another farmer will jail. So why you are not asking about me? Like that, they will ask such kind of questions, right? So you need to explain that I have taken a sample. How many farmers in your village I have taken the data. So this person has only selected. That's why I'm not able to select you only, or else I'm not able to collect information from you. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, within the probability sampling method, there are 5 methods are there. Simple random method, stratified sampling method, cluster sampling method, systematic, and multi-stage random. There are 5 sampling methods in random sampling method or probability sampling method, right? So in non-probability sampling method, there are 4 or 5 sampling methods are there. Convenient sampling method, judgmental sampling method, quota sampling method, snowball sampling method, and purposive sampling method also there, right? So here, so whether you can follow probability sampling method or non-probability sampling method. So after selecting in the probability sampling method, we can determine the sample size. Sample size. Then execute a sampling frame. Okay. Am I clear, dear students, about the sampling design process? So this is very important from now onwards to the PG courses, MSc or MPhil or PhD and PDF. This is the same procedure which the researchers can follow, this sample design process. Okay, am I clear, dear students?
Sir,
sir, what is
the sample size? No, sir. Then why yes, should we again determine the appropriate sample size? Already we have done it in the past, no, sir, in second step.
Yeah. See, for example, yeah, you have the good question that here determine sampling frame and here determine the appropriate sample size. So when I'm going to teach about random sampling method, So then I will show that how we can determine sampling frame and determine some appropriate sample size also. See here, sometimes if you take into account sampling frame, for example, if you take into 100, this is a 10% out of 5% out of 2000, right? So as per some rules, we need to take 10% in order to get accurate results. For example, if you take best example for you from your class only, there are 30 students in your class. If I take feedback from only one student, what will you think?
It will not give the correct results, sir.
Yeah, that is the case. See, there is a 2000 population are there. If I take only 100, I may not get good results. Right? So here we need to determine sampling frame. Then only we can determine this appropriate sample size. Then only we will get an exact accurate results. For example, here out of 2000, if I select 100 only, I may get results which is biased also. Sometimes, if I increase the sample size, I may get a good results. For example, if I ask the question earlier, I told you that if I ask the only one person, the results may be biased. For example, other person may say that very good or very bad. I don't know. But if I ask the question about if I ask the question to the only 5 students out of 30. See what you can think. Out of 5 people, 3 may say that very bad, sir. 2 people may good. They say that bad, sir. So out of 5 people, I may say that majority, nothing but 3%, nothing but out of 5, there are 3%. 3 people have said that. So the class is bad or very bad. So in that case, if I collect information from another 5%, then I may select. For example, whatever I select a sample, the students are not familiar with my subject. For example, those who are studied earlier, it is very easy to them. Those who are studying first time, it is not easy to them, right?
Yes, sir.
Am I clear? Yeah. So in that case, we can determine the appropriate sample size. So we can discuss in the systematic sample size about the appropriate sample size. We'll discuss. Don't worry. So it's a good question which is asked by someone. May I know your name, please?
Kavyashri, sir.
Yeah, please. Thank you. See.
Sir?
Yeah, please.
What is probability sampling and non-probability sampling, sir?
Probability sampling means, probability sampling is random sampling method. Here it means simple. Each and every sample has got an equal chance to be selected. Okay, here simple you can see probability sampling means each and every unit or each and every part or each and every segment has got an equal chance to be selected. That is called probability sampling, right?
Okay, sir.
And non-probability sampling means or non-random sampling means if each and every unit of the population has not got an equal chance to be selected, that is called non-probability sampling. It is quite opposite. Am I right?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Then tomorrow we will discuss briefly about what is meant by probability sampling and what is meant by non-probability sampling method and what are the types of probability sampling methods are there, and we can deeply discuss what is simple random and stratified, cluster, systematic, multi-stage. Then within the non-random sampling, we can discuss what is convenient sampling, judgmental sampling, quota sampling, and snowball sampling, right? Okay. Shall I close the session, dear students?
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
So if you have any doubt, you can ask me now. We have the 2 minutes, last 2 minutes. Dear students, if you have any doubt regarding to the today class, you can ask.
Sir, in the probability, in the probability sampling, it is just like